The following program was provided by an independent producer solely responsible for its content. The opinions expressed do not necessarily represent the views of this station, its staff, board of directors, or underwriters.
Hi everyone, welcome to In Litchfield. I'm your host, John Latcha. We're on the road in Manchester, New Hampshire at the New Hampshire Food Bank. We have three chefs that are going to give you a variety of demonstrations for the next half hour. So let me introduce each one of them to you. First we have Jason McCarter. He's a chef trainer here at the New Hampshire Food Bank. Next we have Paul Morrison, who's a production chef here at the New Hampshire Food Bank. And lastly, we have Rob Clough. He's an executive chef at the Manchester Downtown Hotel. Welcome, guys. Thanks for coming on.
Oh, it's great. Thank you.
Well, yeah, thanks for having us.
Are you guys all excited now?
Definitely.
We're totally excited.
Definitely.
Absolutely. I had a question for all three of you guys. Do you guys, like, when the cooking gets going and everything, you're smelling all that good food and stuff,
yes.
Do you guys, like, sing and dance, too, or?
Well,
I sing, they dance.
Singing,
that's how it works.
Yeah, there's a little bit of both.
Yeah.
Well, you guys take a look at this with me and check these guys out, okay?
Sure.
All right.
That old man River, he must know something. And don't say nothing, he just keeps rolling. He keeps on rolling on.
Okay, so what did you guys think about that video?
Oh,
that's great. That's great.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah,
I would have liked to see Chef Rob in that video. That's what I would like to see. Well, you know, from the waist up.
Yeah.
From the waist up, yeah.
Okay, now, Jason, after the break, you're going to talk to me a little bit about the New Hampshire Food Bank, okay?
Absolutely. Right. I'm so excited about this.
Okay, great. Yeah. And we're going to do that right after this. So stay with us.
Clean kitchen surfaces, utensils, and hands with soapy water. 1 in 6 Americans will get sick from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
Okay, we're back from the commercial break. I'm here again with Jason McCarter, who is the chef instructor here at the New Hampshire Food Bank. First, I want to say, Jason, thank you so much for inviting us here.
Well, thanks for having us.
Mm-hmm.
It's always a pleasure to get our message out amongst the community about what is that we do here at the New Hampshire Food Bank. Our message sometimes gets you know, squelched by everything else that's going on in the world, in the community.
Mm-hmm.
So it's important to know what's going on here at home.
Yeah. So how long have you been with the New Hampshire Food Bank?
I've been with the New Hampshire Food Bank for almost 10 years now.
Wow.
I built the first training facility and now this kitchen here. Almost 10 years.
So what is the mission of the New Hampshire Food Bank, Jason?
The mission of the New Hampshire Food Bank is to serve the folks in our communities that are at risk for going hungry.
Mm-hmm.
Hungry. And those folks are mostly children. Lots of them are veterans, lots of them are elderly folks, and so it's really trying to target each community around the state and figure out what those communities need. And they alter, you know, from the seacoast to the city areas to the urban areas or the rural areas, it differs very, very much. And so we have to try to adapt to each of those areas and figure out how to serve those populations the best that we can.
Mm-hmm. Now you have a program called Cooking Matters. Is that sponsored by Walmart or?
So Walmart is a great sponsor of uh-huh. Cooking Matters. Cooking Matters is actually a national program sponsored by Share Our Strength organization.
Okay.
And so Cooking Matters is a program that goes out into the community and does cooking lessons, nutrition lessons, how to stretch your dollar lessons. Mm-hmm. It's like a 6-week cooking series in the community, taking at-risk populations and helping them do better with the mm-hmm. resources they have.
Now you're in charge of the culinary training program here, Jason. Tell us a little bit about that.
Our culinary program, we started, like we said, 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. There's lots of culinary programs across the United States, and we tried to model ourselves after several other food banks that have started before us. Mm-hmm. We're the shortest program across the United States, and so we do an 8-week culinary program. Mm-hmm. There are other food banks that do 12, 14, and 16-week programs. And our goal is to take folks that are underemployed or unemployed and give them job readiness skills. Culinary skills as well as job readiness skills. And so there's kind of two different areas there. We want to make sure these folks know how to cook. They know the basics of cooking. They know the basics of knife skills and safe food handling and all of the culinary aspects of the job. And we want to make sure that they're good employees. So showing up on time and paying attention to detail and taking pride in what you do. Those are employability skills, and there's not really good teachers of that out there.
Right.
And so we try to attack from both angles and give our students the best options that they have going forward. And mm-hmm. then some of those folks go into really strong line positions at fancy restaurants downtown, and some of them go into school positions and corporate cafe positions. But we're trying to, you know, there's lots of different aspects of the food business that you can get into, and we're mm-hmm. trying to place our students in all of those different places.
Right. Now you have at the food bank, you have what is called a production garden as well as a mobile food pantry. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah. In our first year, we were offered a plot of land. It's at the what used to be referred to as the Johnson Unu Center. It's the youth detention facility on South River Road here.
Right.
We have a whole acre plot of land there. Oh. And so we have a full-time gardener, and we plant a whole bunch of vegetables every year. And when the harvest starts coming in, we use a ton of volunteer labor to do it. But when that product starts coming in, we have the option up here in the kitchen to utilize it for the product first, and then it goes out to our agencies, whatever we can't. And oftentimes, I mean, zucchini and summer squash, you know,
right.
we're in the Northeast, right?
Right,
so
right.
That stuff just grows rampant. We can only use so much, and then the rest goes out to our agencies. And so folks aren't getting, you know, what we get here at the food bank is what the community thinks is the second best, you know, the things that have been in grocery stores for a little bit of while
right.
before it gets to us. They're getting fresh from the farm right here. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they get to take that back to their agencies and distribute it, which mm-hmm. is awesome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now tell me a little bit about volunteers. Here, from what I understand, they sort, redistribute the food, and it goes directly to those in need. How important is volunteering, number one? And how does one become a volunteer?
First, I can't stress enough. You can watch the news all you want, whatever channel you want. The number one way that you can impact this world is by volunteering. Whatever purpose you want to volunteer at, the number one way you can make a change is by volunteering. And mm-hmm. we couldn't do what we do here without the awesome volunteers. Mm-hmm. I've been here for 10 years. I look at some of the folks that are in our sorting area
yeah.
that had been there almost 10 years before I started.
Wow.
And they come in and volunteer 4 days a week. 4 days a week, almost a full-time job. And they sort food for us.
Isn't
and
that nice?
They yeah. are absolutely beautiful, wonderful people, and they are what makes this world go round.
Great.
You can't do it without volunteers. You want to make a difference. Your pocketbook can make a difference, absolutely. But your physical presence, doing something that matters, makes a difference. And so you can go to the NewHampshireFoodBank.org
yep.
website.
Mm-hmm.
You can sign up to be a volunteer.
Okay.
We have so many different opportunities. You can be a volunteer right here in the kitchen. You can be a volunteer down in the warehouse, sorting the non-perishable goods that come in
jobs,
through us
right?
by
yeah.
the truckload.
Yeah.
You can sort frozen meats that come in through the warehouse.
So there's plenty to do here, right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Right.
We have less than 30 full-time employees here. We're a 55,000 square foot warehouse that distributes almost 14 million pounds of food a year.
Wow.
And we have less than 30 employees to do it with. We could not do it without the volunteers.
Mm-hmm.
And so you want to make an impact. You want to make an impact with 8 hours of time?
Yeah.
We'd love you. You want to make an impact with 8 hours a week? We'd love you even more.
Okay.
You can make an impact. If you're tired of watching the news, come here. Make an impact.
Okay. Yeah. Jason, do you have any success stories that you'd like to tell our viewers at home about? I know you could probably get a ton of them, but
we have
any ones in particular?
I can't tell you. We have over 500 students have graduated this program, and I couldn't mm-hmm. be more proud of the folks that are out there working in this industry. We certainly have some that are near and dear to our hearts that have made really big strides. We've had folks that have gone from an alien status to earning their citizenship,
wow.
to earning their first job and buying their first car and renting their first apartment.
I feel better listening to you
and
already.
It was awesome. It was
yeah.
when that person made their citizenship and
yeah.
and then got the loan for their first car, it was awesome. We've had other folks that have never been in the business that,
mm-hmm.
that named their price when they went out into the workforce. And we have other folks that are running their own kitchens. Kimmy Lavoie, she is a star of our program. She runs Bar One, she runs a kitchen in Bar One in Milford.
Uh-huh.
And she has won all sorts of awards. Best new chef, best new restaurant, best
great.
Burger, best martini.
Great.
I mean, they're just nailing the nails in the coffin. I mean,
and it's wonderful
they're
to see
doing
people
an awesome job.
Excel
yeah.
like that. Yeah,
yeah.
Great.
And we have great chefs in the Manchester area here
huh?
that are hiring our students,
mm-hmm.
and that's just a signature point of our program. We want to put out the person that people want to hire.
Right.
I don't want to turn out a student from our program and graduate a student from our program that can't do a good job.
Mm-hmm.
We want people that can do a good job. And Chef Paul, that you'll meet later, and,
yep.
and myself, we've been in the industry a long time, and we have high expectations for our students. And you got to meet those expectations.
Right.
This business is one that you go out to eat on Valentine's Day with your wife. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter to you who's in the kitchen. It's
right.
your Valentine's Day. It's
right.
your wife. You want that to be special, and they have to pull it off.
Right.
There's a level of expectation there that people have to pull in this business,
mm-hmm.
and people that aren't from the business don't necessarily understand it all the time.
But right.
It's a hard business to be in.
Okay. So coming up, what are we going to do coming up after the commercial?
We're going to learn some about knife skills,
okay.
some proper knife skills that'll all keep
right.
all of your fingers intact, so
yep.
you can always wave with both hands. You know,
okay.
However many fingers you choose, that's fine.
All right.
We're going to learn a little bit of proper sanitation at home.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of people don't know about proper sanitation techniques, and
great.
You could be putting your family in undue harm for no good reason.
Yeah.
Little simple practices that can keep them safe.
All right.
And we're going to cook a few things. We're going to teach about flavor. Listen, if you don't know, you can follow a recipe all you want,
yeah.
but if you don't know the basics, the science behind flavor, you can't make your food taste as good as it could taste, and
okay.
it doesn't take that much effort
right, right.
to make it taste better.
All right.
So we want to teach you food.
So that's coming up
things.
Next then, right?
Yep,
okay.
absolutely.
All right, so we're going to go to a commercial break, so we'll be back right after that, so stay with us. Ha ha!
Cook foods to the right temperature using a food thermometer. 3,000 Americans will die from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
All right, so for those of you at home, one of the most important things at home is to talk about knife safety and knife effectiveness. And I don't know about you, but I bought my mom a brand new set of Hinkle knives, and immediately she cut herself, which is not the intention of what I wanted. Those of us that have been in the industry, we know how to protect our knives, or we know how to protect our fingers, and we want to show you this now. And so Chef Paul's going to demonstrate some very effective knife safety techniques. First and most important, start off with a clean cutting board, with a clean knife, and we're going to teach you about sanitation a little bit later. Second of all is never catch a falling knife. Listen, if your knife falls from the counter, just let it go, all right? Get your feet out of the way. Don't ever try to catch it. It's the most crazy thing that you can ever imagine. However, it's something that most of us will try to do. Don't catch a falling knife. Chef Paul's gonna talk or show us about cutting an onion. An onion is one of those vegetables that we have that almost cuts itself because it's built in layers. And there's different ways that we can cut it. And sometimes we're cutting it because of the size or shape that we want it. Sometimes it's because we're cutting it in what we want it to be when it's finished cooking. And so Chef Paul, why don't you show us?
Chef, what I want to talk about is holding onto the knife first. You actually want to hold onto the blade of the knife. If you can see where my thumb and fingers are, we're holding onto the blade of the knife, and then I'm just gently wrapping my other three fingers around the handle. You're not holding onto the handle, you're holding onto metal.
And so one more time. Show them when you touch the handle.
You're going to hold on to metal.
Yep.
If you can see where my fingers are.
If you remember science class, you'll remember the further you are from the lever, sometimes the less action you have. And so we want to be closer to the lever action here, so we have more control. Yep.
There's some things we teach our students. Basically when you are working on a project on a cutting board, with your knife, as you just relax, the knife falls with the food and makes an X on the board, something like this. That's the way your arm naturally falls. When you try to contort yourself and change direction, it gets uncomfortable.
Can I contort you?
Of course.
So show where the natural thing is, right?
Yeah. It's right here, Chef. Yeah, yeah. It's right
and
here.
Then, and then
right?
watch what Chef Paul has to do to make it this way, right? So we want Chef Paul to be relaxed.
We want to be not uncomfortable. Right.
We want him to be relaxed.
So you want that nice, comfortable. You want that nice, comfortable feel. So, if what Chef likes to say in our culinary job training program is if the right hand with the knife is the machine, the left hand is the brain. So that the two things don't connect each other until they're touching. So you actually want to touch. You want to make a claw. You want to make a nice big C with your left hand and let that drop across the food so that when the knife blade is actually touching that first knuckle
let's take the food right out of it.
So that you're actually connected to the knife blade. You can feel it, right? So I can be looking and not watching a single thing of what I'm doing, but because the knife is touching my knuckle every single time, I know that I'm not gonna cut myself because I have my good culinary claw. This first knuckle is touching the knife blade, my fingertips are curled behind, my pinky and my thumb are holding on to the food so that there's nothing bad's gonna happen. If the knife falls, twists, contorts, nothing bad's gonna happen. I can just keep going and going and going.
Chef Paul, can you be my Gumby? Can you be my Gumby for a minute?
Of course.
So this is a common thing that people do. They put their wrist on the table.
Yep.
Right. So they put their wrist on it. You see what happens? You see what happens to his whole body? He puts his wrist on the table, right? Because he's kind of lazy and he leans to the side. And now, if you bring the camera in close, you should bring the camera in close. You can see that his thumb is going to get cut.
That thumb starts to creep out.
Yep.
And that's the first thing that's going to get clipped because my thumb is creeping out from the food, keeping that nice culinary claw, that nice C, will keep that thumb and that pinky and all the things, all those precious little digits right behind the knife blade.
So all you folks at home that have cut your thumb while you're cutting something like celery or onions, we know what you did. We know what you did, right? So. What I try to tell people is you should scratch the cutting board with your fingernails. If you can scratch the cutting board with your fingernails, then your hand is in the right position, all right? If you don't feel it with your cutting board or your nails, then you're not in the right position. You got to be scratching it, all right? Just like you're scratching your head, all right?
So, want to talk about the difference between diced and chopped, Chef?
Sure. When you go out to a fine restaurant and you've worked hard for your money, you can tell the difference. And your brain might not be telling you what those differences are, but you can tell that something was made for you or something was mass produced. And Chef Paul and I, we're kind of partial to the trade. Diced vegetables are so much different than chopped vegetables. Chopped is kind of haphazardly what we do at home when we take our knife and we hold it down to the cutting board and we go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth and back and forth until things resemble sort of a size that we want to throw into our dish. Just like that, yeah. And so some things are big, some things are small. They might have 2 angles on them, they might have 9 angles on them. But I guarantee you that if you go out to a fine restaurant and you have something that is fine or small diced on your plate, you will understand immediately by looking at it that somebody took care in what they did for you. And that is the beauty of our business. That is what the people want to do for you that are in this business. So Chef Paul, why don't you show a small dice?
Small dice.
We have a chop over here. Let's talk about a small dice.
I mean,
with onion.
When you're talking about onions, onions have layers already. So there's a certain amount of work that's already done. So what I'm going to do is as you can tell, I have split this onion in half, and peeled it, and left the root end on, which is the key to this whole process because. Anybody that's tried to chop an onion or dice an onion and had those layers spread all over the place understands that you're chasing pieces around the cutting board. So we're going to leave this root end on, and I'm going to make cuts in the onion. But as you can tell, I haven't cut all the way through. So if you think about dice, a dice is a square. So now we have, if you look at the piece, we actually have 3 of our 4 parts of a dice. And the onion's not going to fall apart. We're not chasing it all over the board. I simply turn my onion, use my good culinary claw, and dice away. So as you can tell, I have these nice, beautiful little squares of onion instead of this menagerie of oddball shapes and size chopped. So like Chef was getting to, the difference between diced and chopped is this very thing right here, where you have a nice, beautiful finished product as opposed to a haphazard
So some things that you might want to finely dice or mince are things like maybe a salsa that goes on top of something,
yeah.
Right? And so if you had like a mango and red pepper salsa that goes on top of a crab cake, you'd want it to look so uniform and so beautiful to present to you. But maybe, chef, if I say, hold on, let's just take this to the side. If I said beef stew, what would you do, chef?
I'd do a larger dice.
Yeah.
Which means all I'm gonna do is take the same process. Again, I have my onion peeled. I've left the root end on. Now I'm just gonna go a little farther out. On my dice, once again, I've cut through the onion. I have nice large these planks of onion that now, when we make squares, again, we have nice, beautiful squares of onion.
Believe it or not, we eat with our eyes. And when you go out to eat somewhere and you order something like beef stew or shepherd's pie, or you get a crab cake with a salsa on top, we eat with our eyes. And it's this activity by the chefs in the back that force us to look at things with our eyes and judge things with our eyes. Perhaps you can show a little bias cut, chef. You know, what chef's doing over here on the side, everybody at home ought to do. This is having a bucket left over for all of your ends of your vegetables, your trimmings of vegetables, your onion skins. Put this in a pot, get it up to a simmer, turn it down, let it go for about an hour, and you'll have a vegetable stock. And you can put vegetable stock in whatever you do. If you had nothing to put your vegetable stock in, make your rice out of it. Boil your pasta in it. Something to add flavor. These are things that you paid for that you don't want to throw away. You have flavor that you're throwing away every day, and you shouldn't be doing that. Get as much flavor as you can out of everything that you buy. So, chef, we've got these basic things, right? These basic things. These are kind of ordinary, American-looking, chef. These are simple-looking things. Show us something. Show us something with some finesse.
You're looking for that crazy Asian slice of a celery. So, I'm gonna go on a strong bias. So instead of making an X with my food, I'm going to make an X, but it's all comes down to where I want to slice at.
This was not like your Fox News bias, right? This is a different bias.
It's a different bias. Okay. Yes. Thank God. So, as you can see, what I have right here is these beautiful julienne slices.
We want to show, thanks for joining us at Litchfield Community TV. We're going to be back with some more segments on this, but I hope you enjoyed what we had to show you tonight, and we're going to show you some more. All right, I'm going to be Chef Crabtree for a moment, and I'm going to talk about food safety at home. And food safety is something that you understand that when you go out and you spend your hard-earned money at a restaurant, that you expect that the ultimate, most highest realm of food safety is being executed on your arrival. And unfortunately, that's not always the case. We have a program called the National Restaurant Association in the United States, and they provide education called ServSafe. And folks that graduate our program here at the New Hampshire Food Bank are ServSafe Manager certified. And we're gonna teach you some of the basics at home in order to keep your family safe. And the first thing is about keeping a sanitary workspace. Now, we all wash our dishes, and sometimes we just wash them with the soap and water, and we put them out to dry, and sometimes we put things to the dishwasher. But a little bit of bleach can sanitize things and keep them safe. Imagine the first time you had a baby at home, and you didn't know what to do with the bottles and the nipples. You sanitized them. You figured it out. It was either bleach or you used the hot water and you boiled them. This is what we want to use. 1 tablespoon of bleach per gallon of water. That will sanitize your workspaces. If you have a wooden cutting board, do this, okay? If you have wooden Wooden handle knives. Do this, okay. Everything else you put through your dishwasher. If you can't put it through your dishwasher, do this to make it safe, okay? The next thing we're gonna talk about is when you finish cooking a meal, you need to understand how to cool it down properly, all right? There are things that we do in the commercial industry, and there's a thing called the temperature danger zone. Okay, it goes from 41 degrees Fahrenheit to 135 degrees Fahrenheit. When you're done serving your family their food, it's probably just over 135 degrees Fahrenheit, and your temperature of your refrigerator is around 41 or below, hopefully, Fahrenheit. This middle area here, this is where bacteria grows, and we don't want bacteria to grow. We want to take every opportunity to make sure the bacteria doesn't grow. So we have to refrigerate things fast, down to 41 degrees below. So when you have leftovers, you should bag them, maybe, with a Ziploc bag. Bag it, but don't zip it, all right? Bag it, but don't zip it. Maybe you can put it in some ice water inside the sink with the zip open so that it cools down fast, and then zip it open and or zip it closed and put it in a refrigerator. Sometimes it's a pot of soup. Put it in the sink with some ice and some water and get it cooled down fast. Stir it often before you put it in your refrigerator. Don't ever put anything hot in your refrigerator. It's the cardinal sin, all right? Bag it, but don't zip it, okay? Once you get things down, 135 to 41, now the next day you might have to reheat it, okay? We want to reheat things to 165 degrees. That might be within the oven, that might be in a pan on a stove, that might be in the microwave. Listen, get rid of your microwaves, you don't need them. Get rid of the microwave. You can use a fancy thermometer like this, okay? That gives you the little LCD readout. You can use a bimetallic stem thermometer. You can get them for a couple bucks at the grocery store, Hannaford's, Market Basket, wherever you shop. They sell stuff like that. Check the temperatures once in a while. It's your family. It's the people that you care most about in life. Do it right for them, all right? When you go to a restaurant, you expect everyone else to be doing it for you, and that is the secret of our profession. We're trained. We're always looking out for your safety, and we're following rules like this to make sure it's good for you. Do the same for your loved ones, and do it at home. How you doing? I'm Jason McCarter from the New Hampshire Food Bank, and this is your next installment of the Litchfield Public Television program. I want to introduce my friends, Chef Paul Morrison, who is the right hand here of the New Hampshire Food Bank Culinary Job Training Program, and Chef Robert Klupp, who is from the downtown Manchester Hotel, correct, Robert? Yeah. So we're gonna talk tonight about creating flavor. There is all sorts of things going on in your home, and we want to simplify it. We want to make everything that you do more successful, and it's very, very easy, all right? You have to stop working so hard. These two gentlemen are going to walk you through some things about making flavor. And the first thing about making flavor is creating color, all right? Creating color. There's this scientific fact called the Maillard reaction, and it happens well over 145 degrees when a protein and the sugars in the protein caramelize on a hot surface. And this can happen in the oven when you brown bread. This can happen in a pan when you saute something or when you sear something. And when you create those colors, that is what creates flavor. Most often, especially, it's a big difference when you go out to eat. When you go out to eat, these restaurants, they have high BTU burners and charbroilers, and they're able to put things on at a very intense heat and create that color and flavor. And when you try to duplicate it at home, it just doesn't work the same. When you put things in a pan at home, all of a sudden things start to steam. and they create lots of steam in your house, but they don't brown. It's because you don't have necessarily the same amount of BTUs. So if you understand the science to flavor, it makes a big difference. And so we're going to talk about the Maillard reaction, and the chefs look like they're looking to sear some things and to grill some things and talk about the do's and don'ts.
We're ready to go, Chef.
All right.
Salt and pepper. Season early, season often. A lot of home cooks, because salt and pepper is at the end of the recipe, that's when they add it. And that's not what you want to do. You want to add layers and layers of flavor. As you can tell, Chef Rob has got a space for all these parts. Go ahead, Chef. We have a beautiful cast iron pan behind us.
Did you hear that at home? Did you hear it at home?
Can you hear that sear?
That sear, yeah, that thing going on home. That's all right. Turn your fan on high. All right, don't try to get away with the number one fan with your home situation. Turn it all the way on high. Get that pan smoking hot. All right, and whatever you do, when you put your food in the pan or when you put your food on the grill, don't touch it. Be patient. Patience equals flavor. All right.
There's a chemical reaction that happens when you add cold food to a cold pan. There's an actual chemical reaction that adheres the proteins to that pan, and until the temperature of the food reaches the same temperature of the pan, it will stay sealed. Once they reach the same temperature, then they will separate. Until then, nothing good happens.
We've all had it. When we put chicken on the grill at home, we have a bunch of family over, we put the chicken on the grill, and we go to turn the chicken, and it sticks. It sticks because it's not ready yet. You have to leave it longer. Turn the grill up a little bit. It has to stay longer at that temperature till the iron or the steel of the grill matches the temperature of the chicken, and then it will release automatically. And then you can flip it over. You want to create lines. You want to create color. That all equals flavor. Look at these two professionals going at it.
We're having a blast, Chef. You can't stop us.
These two gentlemen have fed thousands among thousands of wonderful customers over the years. Between the three of us, there's got to be 90 years. Yeah? How old are you?
42.
42. When did you get into the business?
16.
All right, so yeah. 90 years of experience.
Close to 100 years of experience.
Feeding people between the three of us. We figured some of this out. You see all that? You see all that brown right around there? This is all flavor, all right? If your steaks don't have that brown, they're not going to have the flavor that you get at a restaurant. Let's look at this beautiful stuff that's over here. We've got some seared steaks, some in a pan, some in a grill. We got some vegetables going on here. Chef, tell us what's going on.
I want to talk about another cardinal sin is not resting your meats. And what I mean by that is taking the hot, your hot, beautifully grilled steak or seared steak off the fire, bringing it to the table and slicing it up. Because what's going on in there is all those little molecules, all those little beautiful juice molecules are dancing all over the place. The hotter it is, the faster they're moving.
And they get tense, right?
They do.
Like when you're mad at me.
I'm tense a lot.
You have to relax.
But that's okay. So those little molecules are dancing all over the place. So what happens is when you cut into that piece of meat, those little molecules are still dancing all over the place. And what ends up happening is the best part of your steak ends up being pulled up on the cutting board and not back in. So we've let our meats rest a little bit. As you can tell, there's a very minimal amount of liquid on the plate, and there's none here on the cutting board. We've let those molecules cool down a little bit and slow down so that all the nice love, look at that beautiful rare piece of meat. All that nice love is right in the meat. It's not lost on the outside of the cutting board.
You mean that rare piece of meat? What rare
nuts.
Piece? Well, I don't see the rare piece of meat.
Damn. It's a beautiful thing.
preceding program was provided by an independent producer solely responsible for its content. The opinions expressed do not necessarily represent the views of this station, its staff, board of directors, or underwriters.